everyone. My name is Chu Sing. I have 4 kids. My husband wants to mention that we have helped the church grow by 4 extra people. I'm homeschooling the older 2. The oldest one is 10 and the youngest is 3. So we came to the city, I was just trying to recall just now, after I got married, so 2011. So when I was 28 years old and I turned 40 this year. So I was just thinking like, wow, I spent my 30s in this church, and actually the church has played such a big role in shaping my 30s and I think like nudging us on the right way as we navigate having children and just parenting them, and it's so hard having a strong marriage and keeping your eyes focused on the important things that the Lord has for us. So I'm just very thankful that in my 30s that I've had this church, and like the imagery of a ship came to mind, and the ship with the anchor at the bottom, and that was God, and the chain was really actually people in this church. And I want to just give honor to my husband, who is the one who forced me out of my comfort zone from my chair that I had, that the usher would save for me for years in Coos, to uproot us to come to the city, because he said, you know, you can't be a bench warmer on one chair anymore. You have to come to a small church and serve, and we have to serve in this church. And so we did, And so I'm so thankful that we had PD and Joy and then our life group. And, you know, I'm just looking out at the sea of people. And, yeah, I'm just so thankful for the Fongs and the Tongs and the Ungs and, yeah, all these people who have played such a big role in just helping us navigate my 30s. Yeah. Okay, so anyway, the verse today is John chapter 13, verse 1 to 17. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour has come, that he should depart from this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And supper being ended, the devil having already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, rose from supper and laid aside his garments, took a towel and girded himself. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel with which he was girded. Then he came to Simon Peter, and Peter said to him, Lord, are you washing my feet? Jesus answered and said to him, What I am doing you do not understand now, but you will know after this. Peter said to him, You shall never wash my feet. And Jesus answered, If I do not wash you, you have no part with me. Simon Peter said to him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Jesus said to him, He who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean, and you are clean, but not all of you. For he knew who would betray him. Therefore he said, You are not all clean. So when he had washed their feet, taken his garments and sat down again, he said to them, Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you say well, for so I am. If I then, your teacher and Lord, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is sent greater than he who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Shusin. Can I just invite Pastor Soo Inn up? Let's just have a time where I'd like to lead us in prayer for him. All right, you ready for the word?
Yes.
All right. We pray for you. Yeah, I pray. Oh, no. It's all shit. In the same house.
Okay.
All right. Come on, let's stretch out our hands and just pray for Pastor Soo Inn before he speaks. God, we thank you for this morning. We can gather as your people to be shaped by you, shaped by your word. And even as Pastor Soo Inn is about to speak. God, we just pray that our hearts be one with you, even as you've led us through from the start of the service until now. We ask that would you speak to each of us, even not just through his words, but the life that he represents, the journey he's been on with you, and the work that you are doing individually in our hearts and in us as one community. God, we thank you for your presence. We acknowledge that you're here, not just for us to know your presence, but to be formed as your people. And so we say yes, even from the word that we've read, from this passage, may you speak to us on your heart and reveal your heart to us all the more as we hear this message. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Morning.
Morning.
So I was looking at Axel saying goodbye to Andre especially. I had this vision of Boromir and Aragorn. I don't know why. For those who watch, a lot of the rings, not my master, the one. You remember that scene? Huh? You remember? Yeah. You can do it again later. Okay. But I think it tells us that we relate with each other at many levels. And in Christ, it's all good. I mean, yeah. No, I just lost a good friend to cancer 3 days ago. He was a pastor in Penang and a dear friend. Reminds us again of the preciousness of life and how we should treasure each other. Okay, before I get too emo, Bernice and I look forward to our annual visit to the city. You're only allowed to come here once a year. I don't know. In fact, Pastor Andre reminded me it was exactly almost a year ago that you came and preached. So I look forward to next year. No, in his list, there are people who are allowed to come 2 times a year, 3 times a year, and there's a list for those allowed to come only once a year. And there are lists of those who cannot come at all. So I'm grateful. I am grateful, brother. I'm still very grateful. Well, this is a chance to share with you all a bit of our ministry, Grace Works. And our heart is to see lives touched through friendship. It's so simple. I think so many of our churches, we are very strong at teaching, at activism, save the world, whatever. But the church can be very lonely at all. And how do we be truly a family of friends walking together? Like what we saw just now when we said goodbye to Axel. I mean, that should be the spirit. So that's our ministry, which we do through teaching, through mentoring, and also through publishing. And hence my beloved wife and the book table outside. I'll briefly mention 3 books that we did since we were last here. One we may have mentioned before is Colors of the Kingdom, is the issue of racism in our churches. I think racism is probably the last sin to die, I tell you. And when it's a gospel statement when they see a community of people from different races where all are loved and welcome, it's a gospel statement. Hey, how y'all do this? Let me tell you about Jesus. So this is Colors of the Kingdom, is about racism in the church. A big thing for us is the Generations Project. Some of you may have heard about this. It's a 2-3 year project where we interviewed hundreds and hundreds of Christians in Singapore from Silent Generation to Gen Z. Because their formative experiences have been different, so they view life and even faith a bit differently. We hope at least your leaders will pick this up, because we want to ensure that there's minimal conflict between the generations. And maximum contribution from every generation for the purposes of God. But for that, we need to understand ourselves. So whenever we read this book, then my most joyous response is parents will come to me and say, oh, no wonder my children like that. That's my greatest joy to hear this. But we are hoping that children, oh, my father like that, why? So it cuts both ways. We have a vision of intergeneration, not next gen. It's not just the old having to understand the young understand the old. Old and young, we hold hands and serve God together. And the latest one is assault on the body, which is not a very pleasant topic. It's about sexual assault in the church in Singapore today. Something that we don't think about. We think that sexual assault is something that happens far away, Australia or among Catholics. We don't think it happens among us in Singapore, but it does. So we may not want to look at this book every day, but we should look at the book sometime. So if someone in our midst does suffer sexual assault, I don't think it will happen, but if it does, do they know what to do? So I'm glad that Pastor Simon is here, because Redemption Hill is the two or three churches that have really provided leadership in this area. So it's one of those, we wish we could sell many of this because we need the money. But yet, we hope a day will come and this book is not needed anymore. Yeah. So do go and visit the book table. Make sure we have enough money for Christmas. And like that. I thought this is a church where we speak truth, right? No? Yeah. Yeah. Nah, honest, can be honest, yeah. But then I heard that financially you're struggling also. So. I think one recent reminder of my age is that I had to go for cataract operations. This is the first time you have seen me without specs. First time ever. I have worn spectacles since 1967, when I was in Sec 1. Yes, do the calculations. Sec 1. I had to start wearing specs. I've been wearing specs ever since, until a couple of weeks ago. So now I look at the guy in the mirror. Hey, who's that? Oh, it's me without specs. It's, yeah. But it reminds me that I first graduated from dental school. In my first life, I was a dentist. This is my second life. First life, dentist. In 1978, the time it was called University of Singapore. So not even NUS. So yeah, old man, old. University of Singapore, 1978, I graduated as a dentist. And I remember that time very clearly, because before you graduated, you were just Mr. Soo Inn or Mr. Tan. Or but after you graduate, as a dentist, like doctors and vets, we are allowed to call ourselves doctor. The doctor is in the house. And I remember one of the first times I led worship after I graduated, they put the list of those who were on duty that day. They put Mr., they never put doctor. Oh, that disturbed me greatly. Then I cannot sleep. Hey, I worked my butt off for 4 years to be called doctor, and you never... So, cannot say bad words. Then the next day I call up the church office. This is Dr. Tan here. Next time when you put my name on the roll, make sure it's doctor. Okay, don't forget. Soo Inn, in case you forget, this is Dr. Tan Soo Inn. Soo Inn, in as in holiday, in Tan Soo Inn, yeah. Now I look back at the incident, of course, with great embarrassment. I said, wow, finally I've graduated. I'm now allowed to alleviate pain, restore people's oral issues. I can help people now who come with need for aesthetic and functional recovery of their dentition. I can help people. But no, hey, call me doctor, call me doctor. So instead of being really happy that I can now be qualified to help people, I was obsessed with titles. No, I can now walk through the hospital with my lab coat flapping with doctor there. But you get this, right? Yeah. That this is the society we live in, and in this world, you work hard, especially those of us who are diaspora from India, China, our grandparents came and they went through horrendous poverty. We want to be somebody. So we work hard so that we have that degree or that profession which marks us out as different, better, superior to others. You look forward to that role where you have your own parking space. Hey, that's my parking space. Hey, hello. A key to the executive washroom. But it's a very important man. This, we don't say, because politically correct. No, nothing. But inside. We are supposed to be honest, right? Honest. Honest in the city. Honesty in the city, okay. But when we encounter what Jesus and God thinks of greatness and significance, it's totally different, it's totally foreign. We don't understand what a big challenge this is. How countercultural, for all of us at whatever backgrounds we come from. And so I'm going to go through, as you know my style, I like to go through a passage, so that when you go back to the passage next time, you see the logic of that passage. You don't need the speaker anymore, you know the logic of that passage. So it's the famous passage in John 13, and I will bring us through this, and then I will pick up about the 3, 4, 5 points from that passage. So Lord, speak to us, break down defenses, give us obedient hearts, speak to us, O Lord. So it was just before the Passover festival, and Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. When you see the word Passover, it may not mean much to you. You know, we know it's part of the Bible kind of thing. But if you're a Jew and you see the word Passover, it triggers off a memory of significance that in their history, when they were trapped without hope in Egypt, that God intervened with a mighty strength, did what was necessary to free them. It would stir their heart. For us, oh, Passover. No. But for the Jew, Passover feast is a regular reminder of their God who went at a hopeless time in their history, trapped in Egypt with no hope, and how God did what was necessary to free them. Passover. Of course, it included the death of the Passover lamb. That was a sacrifice needed. Miraculous salvation through the Red Sea. But it is a community spirit defining memory. That's what Passover. So when you read Passover, if you're a Jew, Passover, boom, all these feelings and memories will come to mind. And Jesus knew that the hour had come. There's always this concern that there's something for that he needs to do. He needs to go to the cross, and that hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Again, therefore, the rest of the chapter is an explication, is a demonstration of what that love looks like. Now, having loved his own, he loved them to the end. If you ever wonder whether Christ has stopped loving you, no, hello, there it is. He's kind of a God who loves you and loves you to the end. This is in Scripture. It's a God who loves you and loves you to the end. If you are here going through a rough time, God seems silent, but we know the character of God. He's one who loves you and loves you to the end. The evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Just as a small aside, that means whatever the enemy throws at us, God uses it against him. He cannot win one. Whatever he tries to do against God and his purposes, God is big enough to use that against him. So, Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, that he had come from God. He knew who he was. He knew his power. That means what he did is not so much that I got no power, so I got to wash people's feet, but it was an extension, an expression, intentionality of what he wanted to do. It's not done out of weakness because he had no choice or what. You know, God had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God. He knew that he was the child of God. It's not that he have to do this. He's got all power. He chooses to do it. There's an intentionality about what is going to unfold. And he was returning to God. So he got up from the meal. He took off his outer clothing, wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. And I suspect for most of us, we have read this passage so often, it doesn't really bug us anymore. No? Yeah, wash feet, yeah. But you must understand in that culture what this means. That's why it's important to know the cultural context. In those days, people don't have covered shoes, right? They wear open sandals. And you walk from one place to another. And so as you walk, dust will coat on your toes, dried dung, whatever lah, out there in the streets. It's not tarred roads, it's dust track. Yes, yucky. And then it will mingle with your sweat, producing a powerful combination that you can smell a mile away. So if somebody invites you to their home for a meal, the most basic act of hospitality is to get someone to wash your feet. You expect that. Oh, I'm going for a meal at pastor's house. Or first thing I go there, somebody's going to wash my feet because this is standard. Feet, pong, chow bi, just yucky. So I go and somebody's going to wash my feet. This is expected. This is the usual practice.
But this job, it's a really a dirty job, but someone has to do it. It really is the dirty job. And it's so dirty, they will leave it to the most junior guy in the house to do this. So if you're a bunch of slaves who are Jews and Gentile, the Gentile has to do it. If all Jews, then the most junior have to do it. So whenever someone appears to wash your feet, you may not think about it, but the most junior. Junior, hello, rookie, junior. This is the rookie's got the wash feet duty. Hey, who's on duty today? Oh, the youngest, rookie, can wash feet. So the one who washes the feet is the youngest, the lowest. So the meal has begun, the food is out already, and hey, hello, nobody wash your feet. Leh. So you feel yucky, smell is in the room, the food already come up. Isn't that a terrible combination? You want to enjoy, but... You know, and then your feet, so it's very terrible. So what's going to happen? Something is missing. You know, in the to-do list number one, wash feet, didn't happen. So now yucky, pong, not too nice. Lah, like you want to eat your, unless it's durian, it's a different thing. But if you want to eat something, and then there's this pong, and then what is this? So, of course, one of the disciples could have volunteered to do this. Since it's something that is needed to be done. Maybe they were even trying to, you know, encourage each other. Hey, John, you go. John, you're youngest. Go, John. No, I'm closest to Jesus. Peter, you go. Peter, no, you go. Andrew, the zealot. Nobody knows him. Go, ask him. So they're all asking each other to go and do. But, I mean, I'm just speculating, of course. But nobody does it. So it's bong, food coming out. Then after a while, Jesus stands up. Now, they would never think that Jesus was going to wash their feet because he's the leader. Ma. This is always done by the younger. So maybe why is Jesus standing up? Maybe he's going to the toilet. Or I don't know. He's going to the kitchen to bring more food. I don't know. Why is it? But there's never an expectation that he was standing up to wash their feet. Never, never crossed their mind because it doesn't happen in that culture. Then, hey, look what Jesus is doing. What's he doing? Oh, I took off the outer coat, take basin, water. I'm sure there's stunned silence in the room. No, jing, wash one by one, jing. Stunned silence. Where got leader do this? There's stunned silence. Hey, look what Jesus is doing. Yeah, man. Ask you to do. Yeah, you didn't do it. So there's no Jesus going around washing everyone's feet. It's mind-boggling. It's mind-boggling. I fear we have lost this sense of how audacious this act is. Because it never happens, man. It's always the youngest, the weakest, the lowest that does this job. Never the highest. So he goes around, poured water into a basin, began to wash his disciples' feet and drying them with a towel that was wrapped around him. I think in those days, got powder, you put powder, but there's no powder. So he just going. Then he came to Simon Peter, who said to him, he's already watching aghast at all this happening. Then finally he come to Simon Peter, someone said, are you going to wash my feet? Jesus replied, you do not realize now what I'm doing, but later you will understand. That means washing the feet is just a symbol of dying on the cross. I'm not only willing to wash your feet, I'm willing to die for you. So later you understand. No, said Peter, you will never wash my feet. And Jesus answered, unless I wash you, you have no part with me. That means all his life, Peter and all of them had grown up with a particular understanding of how life is structured. Life is when the junior serves the higher. It's still our world to some degree. No, I remember a long time ago, I did taekwondo. No? So don't make me angry, taekwondo. I only had blue belt, never mind, still taekwondo. And one day we were having our training, and this is good. And then our master was from Korea, a short guy who can kill you with one finger, Korea. And he had 6 dan black belt. So training. Then we saw 2 scruffy looking guy come and watch the training. They were Koreans, I think they were sailors from a Korean ship that happened to be in Penang at that time. So then we see the master walking towards these 2 guys. So he's going to put them in their place, no? Then he went to these 2 sailors, scruffy looking, kind of thing. And then he went and carried their bags for them. And found out later, actually, they were 7 done. He only 6 done only. What do we carry? That's the way the world is structured. The junior have to serve the senior, the lower to serve the higher. That's the way, that's the world that Peter grew up in. And to allow Jesus to wash his feet was to dismantle this whole world that he had grown up in. You understand how scary this is? If he allowed that to happen, means the whole structure of life as he understood it, gone. But this is scary. That all my life I worked to get my PhD. Now PhD, no, not important. What the? So you know, something like that. I need PhD here. I'm just using it as an illustration. So I mean, the whole structure of life is changed, man. And I said, no, you can't wash my feet. Then Jesus makes this very important statement. He says, unless I wash you, you have no part with me. At one level, it means you do not allow the blood of Christ to cleanse you from your sin. You cannot be part of this new reality. But I think it's more than that, that Christ is introducing a new reality where we are willing to wash each other's feet. This is the new reality. You want to be in this or not? If you want to retain the old structure, then this Jesus thing is not for you, lah. But if you want to be part of this new reality that Jesus is ushering in, we wash each other's feet. We wash each other's feet. So Peter, whom I love very much because he thinks with his mouth, he's my hero. Lord, if that's the fact, then you just not my feet, but wash my hand also. Head also can. Then I can imagine Jesus smiling a bit and said, those who have had a bath, they don't need to wash their feet, their whole body is clean. I mean, it's not really symbolic, you know. Their feet really needed to be washed. I'm not against foot washing as a symbol. It's a very powerful spiritual discipline. I'm not against it. But in that original context, Jesus was doing something that needed to be done. So they are bathed already, you know, the top part all got deodorant and all that. No need to wash already. But it's the yucky feet that needs to be washed. So Jesus is not here trying to show off how servantly he is. He's actually doing what needs to be done, although it is done by the lowest. And he goes on to say, you are clean, however, not every one of you. Because again, at the back seat, the minor key playing, is Judas is going to betray him. And I presume he washed Judas' feet as well. This Christian faith, crazy one, no? Crazy. You go and wash people, it's going to kill you. Hello, what is this? Okay. You want to follow other easy religion, I can give you some. I don't know. But you want to remain in this house. Sorry. I'm picking up the house language. Well, he knew he was going to betray him. That's why he said not everyone was clean. And when he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. He said, do you understand what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. That means Jesus didn't take off the leader hat, put on the servant hat, then go back, throw off the servant hat, put on the leader hat. He was still a leader when he did what he did. You call me teacher and Lord, and that is who I am. He didn't give up his leadership role. He's trying to tell you what leaders in the kingdom look like. Isn't this threatening to our usual value system? Let's don't play, man. This is something so entrenched in our culture. So you call me teacher and Lord? Correct. That's who I am. And I, your teacher and Lord, no? Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you should also wash one another's feet, which is another mind-blowing statement. See, now I wash your feet, you wash my feet. Oh, yeah, then I'll be all fighting. I'll be the first. No, I'll be the first to wash his feet. That's not you want to do, you never do. No, so you wash my feet, now I wash your feet, now you wash my feet. They'll be fighting to be the first one to wash his feet, right? Want to be in the good graces of the boss. But then he says, now that I wash your feet, you should wash one another's feet. I can see Matthew looking at Simon the Zealot. And Simon the Zealot looking at Matthew, you know. Because I tell you, Simon the Zealot belonged to a movement that wants to overthrow the Roman Empire through violence. And Matthew the tax collector is collecting taxes for the occupiers. So if this is the multiverse, and they are in another universe, if Matthew had met Simon the Zealot in the dark street, another verse lah, not this one. Then Simon the Zealot could easily have taken a knife and But now in this new world, people who are not normally friends now have to wash each other's feet. hey, you wash people's feet as easy. What's the big deal? It's to wash the feet that in this world, in the flesh, we are not inclined to wash. One, then we talk lah. Say, hey, come, how come you're just like that? I say, well, strange. You ask me that. Let me tell you about Jesus. You're just exactly like the world. And what is there to talk lah? And then goes on to finish the punchline. Very truly, I tell you. You know, I've set you an example that you should do as I've done for you. The word do is very important for Jesus. Even in the Good Samaritan, if you do this and you will live, do this. That means it's not just sing this, feel this, think this, live this way. Yes. Often we reduce our faith to just emotional encounters through singing, which is totally valid, of course. But always see Jesus using the word do. Even in the Good Samaritan, you do this and you will live. Here, I've seen you an example that you should do as I've done for you. Yes. Then very truly, I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now, you know these things you will bless if you do them, if you live like this. So, we now go on to the 5 points, which I better do because they did some nice PowerPoint for me. So. Better for the 5 points. And the first of which is this, that the world defines leadership really in terms of position and privilege. We know this. When we meet someone, they ask, oh, are you the CEO? No, lah, I'm just manager only. What? But this kind of language already betrays a certain value system, right? You doctor? No, lah, I nurse only. This is salah, wrong, okay? I'm using that as a negative example. Negative example. Negative example. Then you say, no, I also was sound engineer. No, and that playing the same game. Playing the same game. Justifying ourselves. Defining ourselves by our titles or status or that. I think may also be complicated by the internet world we live in. I see even among churches that people are important only because they are spectacular, they are somehow marked out as better than other people. You look at our church culture, even in the Christian groupings that we talk about. You know, who is the senior this or the... Yeah. So I think friend, in some sense, is the more powerful accolade than pastor. When Exo said, you're my friend, I think that's a much more powerful accolade than my pastor or my leader or whatever. I think the internet makes things worse. Okay, how many are on threats now? Threats. Who's trying threats? Now I feel I'm trapped in the matrix. I can't get out. But threats. That's it. How many followers you got? Yeah. Then you put in an item. How many likes you get? How many reply? So if we get more recognition by followers, by likes, we feel that we are somebody. So who we are, defined by position, privilege, how we are viewed by the world, man. And the internet doesn't help at all. Now this is where Christ, number two, defines true leadership as sacrificial service of others. Remember that this is not just symbolic, it's what they needed. Sacrificial service. And I want to say that it's not necessarily doing the most embarrassing thing. It's that we do what is necessary, what it takes, embarrassing or not. So when you think, oh, wash feet, me, but stoop. What's the most embarrassing thing I can do for you? No. It's what do you need, man? And if I can do it, I will. Whether it's embarrassing to me or not is a non-question at all. So our heart for each other. I always worried about this term servant leadership because it seems to apply to elite group again. Servant leader. So my friend Robert Banks said, why don't you talk about leading servant? No? We are all servants. But some of us have the responsibility of leadership, but we long chong all servants, all of us. So it's not just servant leadership seems to imply it belongs to a certain small elite group. It's the leader. Are you a good leader or not? Are you a serving leader or not? But how about leading servant? Hey, this applies to all of us. All of us are meant to be servants. Some of us have the responsibility of leadership. It's the leading servant, not servant leader, leading servants. And so this is what Jesus shows. This is what it means to be a follower of Christ. Do you want to be part of me or not? This is how you define yourself. This is how you live, whatever it takes. So I think, and this is very tough for me to say because I think I fail big time most of the time. What does it mean to wash the feet of my wife? What does it mean for your wife to wash your husband's feet? for us as parents, what does it mean to wash the feet of our children, especially when they're very young, they can't reciprocate. What does it mean to wash their feet? And the day will come and the child grows up, and what does it mean for you to wash your parents' feet? And that's not always easy. No? What does it mean for the pastor to wash the feet of his people? And what does it mean for the people to wash the feet of the pastor? This is about all of us. And let me say that it doesn't mean that we can't be CEO or senior pastor. Some people interpret this, oh, then as a servant leader, I cannot be a CEO. No, 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 no. The thing is, whatever responsibility God has given you, you bring the spirit of servanthood into it. Not so much that, no, as a pastor, oh, they want me to be CEO, but I'm a servant leader, so cannot. Wrong interpretation. Some of us God may entrust with key responsibilities, and we shouldn't shy away from it if that's what God wants us to do. But we are not defined by the role. I'm not somebody because I'm a CEO. In fact, I bring Christ to define the role, not let the role define me. Who am I? No, I'm Soo Inn. I'm a friend. No, not senior pastor, author, whatever. So we don't get defined by these things. If you have a chance to do them and it blesses people and glorify God, we embrace it. There's not shying away from it just because, but we don't let the role, no. I'm not somebody because I'm a CEO, no. I am somebody because I'm a child of God. No, we don't let the role define us, but don't shy away from responsibility that God gives you as well. So let's not misinterpret this. And just briefly, I need to say also that when we can do this because our self-worth is rooted in our identity as children of God. So Jesus can do this because he knew who he was. He had come from the Father, he was returning to the Father. The whole Gospel of John, there's this consciousness of Jesus as a child of God. But because God has created us with the need for significance, it's because we are not just a bunch of atoms. We are human beings, and we are created with a need for a sense of being somebody. But that sense of being somebody of selfhood is rooted in the fact that God loves me. God loved me enough to create me. Jesus died on the cross for me, to adopt me, to be part of his purposes, to give me a future that no one can take away. So all of you are somebody. All of you. You don't need to do something, get some letters, then you are somebody. You are somebody, all of us, if you know Jesus, because God loves you. I have to remind myself again and again, why am I somebody? Because I don't deserve it, but I'm a child of God. I'm not defined by titles, but I'm defined by my relationship with God. You must tell yourself, and we must remind each other. One way we remind each other is we love each other equally. I don't care where you come from, your race, your title, but in this house, you are equally loved. Sometimes you need to be a bit more intentional, right? Some people may be easier to love than others. But no, let's intentionally do this. We love everybody equally. So say, well, gee, I'm a CEO, no, I have a PhD. Huh? CEO, PhD only, I COG, what is that? Child of God, yes. That trumps everything else, man. I mean, CEO only, I COG, child of God, nothing the world can give nor take away. You are a child of God, daughter, son of God. And that's the root source of our identity and our self-worth. So whatever I need to do, it doesn't touch who I am. If I need to do something embarrassing, my boat's up. Don't care. I mean, if that's what he needs, I will do that. Because it doesn't touch on who I am. I'm a child of God. So I can do something, not always the most embarrassing thing, but I do what is needed, embarrassing or not. We must be this kind of people. They say, wow, so love each other. How about the world out there? I've come to learn that when we love each other within the body of Christ, it actually is preparation to love the world out there. Of course, Jesus said, as the Father has sent me, so send I you. So we are meant to wash the feet of the broken world out there. But we're loving other in-house is training. Because sometimes it's easier to love people out there than people inside. But love people inside, you know, last year what you say about me, I'm going to wash a fellow's feet. You always show off one. Whatever. So, because we know each other, sometimes it's harder to love people inside the house. Love each other outside. Wow, hero, man. Wow, your church are so good. Help people. No, lah. No. So, we so much easier to love folks outside. Serve, washing the feet of outside. Wow, picture appear in paper or whatever. Oh, no, that's not really paper anymore. In the website or something. But loving inside the house, hey man, that's why the Bible talks about accept one another, forgive one another. You live long enough, you all will disappoint and hurt each other. Amen. And then those kind of people, we have to wash their feet. It's got to be a God thing, man. Human nature, you whack me, I whack you. I'm saying that a bit too passionately than I should. But you whack me, I whack you back. But to wash your feet, that I need to be transformed, lah. But towards the end, I think Jesus promises that when we live like this, we will be blessed. Sometimes we think going down some difficult path like this, we will lose out. But Christ promised that when we live like this, we will be blessed. Do you want to be blessed or not? We wash each other's feet, and collectively as a church, we wash the feet of a broken society around us. What is your main takeaway from today? Obvious takeaway is that we should be foot washing people. For me, through the years, as I read this passage again and again, I think to me, the most mind-blowing thing is that Jesus washed my feet. Yeah. That you follow a God who's willing to stoop down and wash your feet. That to me is mind-blowing. Father, who is prophet, priest, and king, high up, that one easier to believe. But a God who can stoop down to wash your feet and mine, that one mind-blowing. Sometimes it's actually easier to wash people's feet than to allow people to wash your feet sometimes. When I was, at some point I began to have this foot washing practice. I thought it was a good spiritual discipline. I found it's easier to wash people's feet than people take picture. Wow, Suin so humble. Like when people want to wash my feet, gilly, ticklish. I found it much harder to let people wash my feet than to be a hero and wash people's feet. And sometimes it's the reverse, man. I mean, would you allow me to wash your feet? Are we humble enough to receive ministry from others and from God? So, depends on where you are in your own walk. It cuts both ways. But I will close with this. I know some of you are going through tough times in your family, individually, as a church you're going through some challenges. And God says, hey, remember, I'm the God who will stoop down to wash your feet, whatever it takes. I'm the kind of God who's going to let you down, man. Let's pray. Father, we repent that because of over-familiarity, we don't let this passage speak to us as deeply as it should. Forgive us. And God said, look at me, look at me. I'm the God who stoops down to wash feet. Look at me. I'm that kind of a God who is high and lifted up, but also willing to stoop down to do whatever it takes to rescue my people. I guess our first response is first, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Then our second response, help us to be like you. Help us to be like you. Amen.